I was going to impress Andrew by having known all of that about him, but I'll just add that the book, the DNA book, was written with none other than Jim Watson.
Not necessarily a good thing. like
yes.
It's a with book, which means that DNA by James D. Watson, all in some sort of mega font. Sort of PK font, despite the fact I wrote the bloody thing. The worst thing was it's published in the UK. These are my people. Okay? And it's the same deal. DNA by James D. Watson. And then you sort of scan down the cover and it says, as seen on TV. That has eclipsed me on the cover of my book in my country. Bloody Brexit. Sorry.
I brought Andrew along mostly to keep me honest and to keep us honest as an actual biologist and as someone whose job at Harvard it is to help people understand biology, including the course that he teaches called Understanding Darwin. There didn't used to be such a thing as a Hebrew college rabbinical student I didn't know. It's sort of a strange feeling to sit here and look out at faces that I don't yet know, because I was here from when we were a one-room schoolhouse. But what I remember and take still to be true is that you know this started as a fevre, as a group of friends and fellow travelers, and I presume it still is. So it's really. In a sense, odd to be looking at folks I don't yet know, but in a sense, right at home to be exactly here. Thank you for having us both here this morning. All right. Since none of you have taken courses with me, let me say that when I used to teach here, and when I teach generally, when I'm doing my very favorite thing, sources and traditions that just light me up, I feel, and that I hope will light others up, I really feel it's important to take moments to look at really difficult things as well. Anyone here who was involved in any courses that I taught will know that in the midst of looking at things which are the reason that I stick with this tradition, and perhaps that we stick with this tradition, I think it's important to look at things that are the ones that make us ask why we don't just throw the whole thing out the window. And there are such things in rabbinic literature, as you know, and in life generally. And I think, and I was saying to Andrew on the drive out here, that any spiritual leader who hasn't gone through some kind of dark night of the soul, confronting the really difficult questions and confronting them honestly, probably isn't interesting enough to be a compelling spiritual leader these days. And if I don't bring us, and if Andrew doesn't help me, bring us face to face today with how really vertiginously terrifying some of the truths of life sciences are when it comes to the enterprise of doing theology, then I have it in other words, if you're not sufficiently shaken a little bit somewhere inside, then I haven't accomplished what I hope this will do. I don't want to, you know, leave you in despair, and you can already tell that that's not in Andrew's nature as well. But I do think it behooves us to be tremendously circumspect and honest and as knowledgeable as we possibly can be, because one of the things I love about this rabbinical school is it's about becoming rabbis in the real world as much as possible, with real people, with the inheritance of our tradition, and in the actual world that we inhabit. And that's nothing, you know, my saying that here, I'm saying that in front of Art, who's written so beautifully about that in Radical Judaism, and Evan thinks about that as well. Practically everybody who teaches here does. But I want to, you know, I'm invited for this session, I want to bring us to, well, there are two focal points, let me say, that I'd like this conversation to have. The first, Stephen Jay Gould used to speak about geology, or science's most frightening fact, which was the age of this earth, and the fact that human life occupies just the tiniest smidgen of the timeline toward the end, and that more than, what is it, 99% of species that have ever existed on the planet no longer do. And that, by Gould's light, was the most frightening fact of life sciences and of geology and biology. I think the most challenging fact for those who are spiritually and theologically oriented is that evolution is not end-directed. Right? Evolution is not properly spoken of teleologically. Right? Which is to say, evolution is determined by what's come before and what exists in the present moment and how that present moment is affected by its circumstances. Whatever mutations arise then are selected by what circumstances they meet in the present moment. So that biology works, or life works, and Andrew can describe this much better than I can, by processing what's come before, not by any foreknowledge of what the circumstances will be. I think that's really important for us to look at, because it challenges such things as, let us make a human being, right? What sense does a biblical sentence like that mean? And what then can our role be meaningfully as conscious inhabitants of this phenomenon? So that's the one point. And the other, also reaching to Stephen Jay Gould, who really addressed the confrontation between science and religion and tried to resolve it, but make peace by talking about separate magisteria, or non-overlapping magisteria, as he put it, which is to say, science is not seeking to answer the questions that religion is seeking to answer, and religion is not, you know, is not outfitted or really should be intending to answer the questions that science is answering. So the two really are separate realms. Science addressing the actual physical world as it is, and religion addressing how human beings ought to live in it. And my difficulty with that, you know, I don't think that science should dictate, or that religion should dictate to science prescriptively, but I do think, in most cases, but I do think that that religionists need to be scientifically literate. And I'm not sure we can do theology properly in a separate magisterium. You know, because there's a tendency when we think spiritually and when we do theology to retreat into a pre-Copernican and pre-Darwinian worldview. That's to say, we tend to look up at the heavens much as our ancient ancestors did, you know, and take everything we see up there in the sky to be the, you know, the beautiful backdrop for a main attraction, a main show happening down here on this earth. Right? That's easier to dispel, you know, because the things we see through the Hubble Space Telescope and so forth are both infinite, if they are infinite and wondrous, and so you're looking at the infinite and the wondrous, and okay, and we're a speck, and that helps with humility. The pre-Darwinian thing is more difficult to overcome, because we're meaning makers, right? And we're storytellers, and we tell stories of ascent and of progress and of hope and of vital force aiming towards something. And that is seriously challenged if we are honest about what biological science sees and says today. And that's what I want us to spend a little bit of time coming face to face with. But first of all, that frightening fact of evolution not being end-driven, and then the question of can we really make peace by saying, okay, well, separate realms, separate magisteria, science will do what it does, and we here in a rabbinical school will do what we do, and we, you know, we can admire one another, and that's what we should, rather than fighting with one another, we can admire one another, and we shouldn't clash with one another, but we really shouldn't presume to overlap, because then we get into speaking past one another or telling one another what we should do in ways that aren't appropriate to science and aren't appropriate to religion. And that's where we get into trouble, is where the magisteria overlap. And then my conviction that somewhere they have to, at least for us. So that's my opening spiel on this. And I've brought Andrew on both to hear what he'll say, which I'm eager to hear as well, and also because he's one of the best explainers of how life works and helpers of people to understand that.
Well, it's a real pleasure to be here. Slightly unusual audience by my standards, so bear with me. I actually think it's, and the way I teach it in the introduction courses, I think it's the most seismic idea in the history of ideas. Forget bloody Copernicus. And it's not just Darwin, it's not just natural selection. The seismic idea is that us, vaunted, exalted, wonderful us, are modified great apes. Okay? That took some serious processing in the late Victorian era, and it's certainly still taking a lot of processing, I can say. Let's face it, 45% of Americans are self-described essentially as creationists, which, by the way, is a stunning statistic. And remarkably, I teach at a rather snooty elite institution, that's fairly high bar to get in there academically, but I run into, not every week, but probably at least a couple show up every month. Kids will come to my office and I was wanting to talk about exactly this issue. And they've probably been educated in the deep south and the Bible Belt somewhere. We're generally talking about sort of evangelical Christians of some kind who are more than just uncomfortable with this idea. And this is, I was telling Jonah driving over, it's actually, it's a somewhat sobering experience. I'm a scientist. I'm teaching a course in evolutionary biology, okay, people? And I'm just laying out some fairly straightforward facts. Some of it's straight out of the Origin of Species, okay? I mean, there's nothing very controversial that I'm doing here, I think. And there's some, I'm a scientist, I'm teaching science. There's some kid, middle back row, who's weeping. Okay? This wasn't the intended effect of my lecture. The reason they're weeping is because they've lived in this, probably as an evangelical bubble or whatever it is. They heard Darwin's bad. Okay, end of story, basically. And yes, if you're in the school system, the wrong part of the Bible, but that's all you know, and that's reinforced when you go to church on Sundays and so on. And so, what I'm actually doing inadvertently is dismantling this poor kid's worldview. Okay, they're in a science class. They're a smart kid. They've made it to Harvard College. And there's this guy. I'm not saying this is nothing controversial. These are the facts. Okay, and I think part of what Jonah's talking about here is that nobody should be in that position. And that's why the sort of denialism that the non-overlapping magisteria, which by the way I use when I teach, because in that first lecture in evolutionary biology course, I want to prevent students from melting down and weeping. Okay, that's not my business. I'm a scientist. Okay, but I also want to make kids with profound religious convictions completely comfortable with the fact that yes, because too many of them have been raised on this idea of a dichotomy. Yes, you can be a completely doctrinaire scientist. You can be a materialistic, naturalistic scientist. You can observe and do experiments. And yes, you can have a completely profound and significant spiritual existence. And I agree, I'm somewhat hypocritical when I teach this. I teach it pure Gould, that there's no overlap, because I don't want to spend 45 minutes getting into the ramifications of these bloody ideas in an introductory evolutionary biology class. But then I always point to scientists who have prominent scientists. I mean, so Francis Collins is a singular case in point. He's the head of the National Institute of Health. He's one of the leading scientists in biology today. And he's a great scientist, and he has a very profound spiritual life, a Christian life, and he's written books about it. and that his Christian life is not compromised by his scientific life, and his scientific life is not compromised by his spiritual life. But I agree with Jonah, he's actually got to make a whole bunch of accommodations. So the obvious example being the text make specific material claims. I mean, if you're going to read the beginning of Genesis in literal terms, then that is a direct conflict with from one magisterium to the next. And this is my gripe, sorry, getting back to it. I'm a biologist. The writer of Genesis irritatingly decided to focus on biological creation. So it's me who gets it in the net. Why could there be some statements about acceleration under gravity or something such that physicists get it in the net? No, it's evolutionary biology, and evolutionary biology is inevitably there for the sort of red flag in this sort of posed. I mean, it's not a real conflict, I'm sure I'm pretty converted here, a real conflict between science and religion. But this is, and again, I'm not going to defend this use of language, but the language is used, this is, evolution is inevitably a key battleground. Which brings us to the main point that Jonah was making, which is on the issue of teleology. And it's confusing, because plenty of evolutionists, and including me if I'm being lazy, will speak in teleological terms. Okay, natural selection is designing something to do something. In the same way, I'm basically just adopting the classic, this is William Paley, the distinguished natural theologian, that with his metaphor of the divine watchmaker. So we talk too often about natural selection as a substitute divine in the watchmaker scenario, essentially. That's just poor use of language. Okay. The other problem is we've got this historical process, starting canonically with Aristotle, I'm sure there are earlier antecedents, of this vision, and this is a supposed a religious vision, of a progressive creation. And that God sort of, if you like, the creator, values things going higher and higher and higher. You've probably seen the beautiful medieval recreations of the Scala Naturae, where you're starting with simple invertebrates, and you get to people, and then eventually get to angels, and so on and so forth. So that's a very ingrained vision. It's a sort of cultural trope. I think it transcends culture. I mean, I think it's a common vision, the ladder of life and the sort of gradual drive up it. The problem is that trope has been transferred onto evolutionary biology, and people think, naively, that evolution is this process of ladder climbing, that there's some kind of driver, and this is ultimately teleological, right, which is starting simple and then plodding up that ladder until that fantastic moment, the sparkling dawn, whenever it was 200,000 years ago when our species came into being, and that was the goal throughout. Nothing could be further from the truth. Now, of course we're interested in us, okay? I'd be sort of sad if we weren't. In my introductory evolution course, I teach a set of courses at the end on human evolution. So in a sense, structurally in my course, I'm confirming this bias I've already said is merely a bias. But why am I doing that? For two reasons. One, we're interested in us. Two, human evolution is such a great way to, it's a great capstone for a course on evolution, because we've talked about population genetics, we've talked about creating family trees, we've talked about the fossil record, we've talked about the process of generating new species, and by studying our own history, we have to deal with all of those things, okay? So we've got this sort of inferred teleology. In fact, and this is a key idea. There's this phenomenal trade-off, which is, this isn't the biological idea. If you're going to be very good at something, you're probably going to compromise your performance at other things. Okay? Now, if in the final section of my, if I'm an elephant, okay? Into the mood, and you're all elephants, and I'm teaching evolutionary biology calls it elephants. What you're going to do, what we're going to do at the final set of lectures, is obviously talk about evolution. And we're going to sit there and we're going to marvel at the at what great things elephants are. And elephants are marvelous things. So whereas in the human version, we're talking about this thing, and that's a marvelous thing. Okay, the elephants were talking about this thing. And you know, you can use it as a drinking straw, you can use it for a dust bite. So you can pick things up, peel a banana. But then there's two bacteria sitting here. They're laughing their tiny little bacterial heads. Because they've read The Origin of Species. They know it's all about reproduction and passing your genes on, as they say. And this is a bunch, I'm talking to a bunch of 20-year-olds, none of whom have reproduced. Okay? I mean, talk about evolutionary failures. These guys are going to have children in the next 20 minutes. Okay? So what's happened is we're really good at being smart. Elephants are really good at doing this. Bacteria are really good at reproducing. Everyone's specialized in doing something really well. And in becoming really good at doing something, you've sacrificed something else. So, the notion of higher and lower in organisms is completely specious. One which a bacterium is not lower on the reproduction scale by any stretch of the imagination. It's probably not as smart as most rabbinical trained. It's smarter than some of you. But the notion that you've got this march and that we're the best is woefully naive. That's one. Two. Natural selection absolutely is a-teleological. Natural selection fixes things best it can under the circumstances it encounters. So you might think, well, there's natural selection. It's driving zebras. You have to use an American accent. It's driving zebras to run ever faster until we've got the perfect whistling zebra hurtling across the plains of Africa. It's not true at all, actually. If we have a population of zebra over here and there are a bunch of lions there, then yes, natural selection is going to favor the fastest running ones. The ones that happen to run a bit faster are going to avoid the lions. They're the ones that are going to reproduce and they're going to be a runner. So you've enriched the next generation for faster running zebras. Another population over here, on an island which doesn't have any lions, there's no reason to run faster. Yes, you'll still probably have the genetic variation for running faster. So there's a running faster zebra there. Doesn't do it any good. Okay, might impress the other zebras. But no, so there's no natural selection operating there. So you've got those two separate populations. Natural selection is driving that one to go faster. And you might say, well, look, that's really dumb. Okay, because lions might eventually make it across to that. Okay, this is the teleological component. So natural selection, if it were smart, would set about selecting for high running speed in this population as well for fear of future lion incursions. It doesn't work that way, okay? That's what I mean. Natural selection is this incredibly in the moment phenomenon. It's not wired, if you like, to be truly teleological, to look ahead, okay? So that's all natural, that's all evolution is. It's this sort of episode after semi-random, contingent, were there any lions present? Yes, there were there. Was the right genetic variation there? Yes, in this case, maybe not elsewhere and so on. It's just this concatenation of interactions between individuals and their environment. There's no driving force. There's no vector, there's no arrow, there's no destination. And my final point I want to make vis-a-vis this is that we're making this slightly into a Stephen Jay Gould appreciation occasion. He was a colleague of mine and I had mixed but he had one really interesting, I think it's a very interesting thought experiment, which is this. Replaying the tape of life. Now, when I talk about this, so what he actually means is, let's travel back in time, say, to early in the origin of animals in the manner, which is about 500 million years ago, the Cambrian explosion. And let's, so freeze frame, It's exactly what happened, what's in the fossil record. And we're now going to take that, and we're going to take the identical, so here it is, the identical planet, so we're going to copy that to another Earth, same conditions, and run it. And then we're going to do it again and again and again. And I'd say his vision for this was replaying the tape of life, which is difficult to explain to undergraduates these days.
We used to have these things called VHS tapes.
It's also a slightly problematic image, because I don't know about you, but even usually VHS tapes have the same outcome, right? I mean, it's the same movie each time, same ending. But the thought experiment, and it is a problem. Evolution is a one-off, right? We're a one-off. Okay. Now, there might be other planets out there. Now, but the question is, and this is key to the teleological question, and I think it's key in some sense to some of the theological questions, are human beings an inevitable outcome? Given that you're saying, okay, we've originated life, we've got sort of simple life that's evolved, and then we let it go for half a billion years, do we necessarily get to people? Is there something structural about the process of evolution that would lead to people? And people disagree about that. It's an interesting debate. Gould, and I'm absolutely with him here, would say absolutely no. And I'll just give you one simple instance. What we call dinosaurs evolved around 235 million years ago. Mammals evolved from a different stock of early reptiles a little bit later, maybe 200 million years ago.
Like a hairy mammoth?
No, actually, nice question. mammals started off about this big. It took a long time to get to the hairy mammoth. Now, what I'm sure most of you know this. The dinosaurs thundered around being dinosaurs. The early mammals stayed at this size. They basically never got beyond big rat size. And there's a good reason for that. There's limited ecological opportunities for being big. There were some organisms out there which were pretty damn good at being big. So any slightly larger mammal is competing with a really effective large dinosaur, end of story, okay? I mean, that's natural selection, people, okay? Mammals stayed small. They were ineffective competitors against the dinosaurs. So what happened to the dinosaurs? As you know, a very large rock came out of space. Now, this is not something that could have been scripted. Okay. It's just something that happened 65 million years ago. And we don't fully understand it, but one thing is clear, we lost all the dinosaurs, save one. Yeah?
The Ice Age was before the dinosaurs, I know.
No. I mean, there were really early Ice Ages. Yeah. And there was one really spectacular, I mean, there have been several spectacular Ice Ages where the whole planet was cloaked in ice. But the most recent Ice Age was a mere, well, it finished about, the maximum was about 18,000 years ago, so that's very recent, not very recent by our standards, but recent by dinosaur standards. Anyway, 65 million years ago, bang, you lose all the big dinosaurs. Yes, you've got some dinosaurs left called birds, fine, but they're kind of unthreatening, generally. Unless you'll be kicked by a cassowary. Mammals made it through, and it's actually really spectacular if you look at what happened just in body size evolution in mammals. So you've got from the fossil record starting 200 million years ago, tiny mammal, tiny mammal, tiny mammal, tiny mammal, tiny mammal, tiny mammal. 65 million years ago, mammal size takes off. Okay. And that's where we come from. We're not rat sized. Okay. I don't think, and Steve's certainly assertion is, without that rock hitting the dinosaurs on the head, there would be no humans. Now, there might have been interesting evolutionary directions producing rather smart dinosaurs. There's some pretty damn smart birds out there, okay? But our species per se, no, okay? So again, and there are plenty of people saying, well, maybe there would have been some kind of version of us or whatever. You know, there are forces in favoring being smart, for example, so maybe some lineage might have gone in that direction. But it certainly wouldn't have been people in the sense we understand them today. So that's what I mean. This is not a predestined, goal-driven process. This is this contingent, haphazard, genetic variation, mutations, serendipitously meets the environment with occasional serious environmental burps, such as a large rock hitting the planet 65 million years ago. And that's what we have. It's this serendipitous journey through a lot of biology which produced us. Nothing purpose-driven, nothing deliberate in that process.
To shift away from Gould for a second.
Yeah.
A writer on biology, and I don't know what Andrew thinks of him, has helped me understand this is the late Ernst Mayr, especially in his book on the new philosophy of biology. And one distinction that Mayr makes that makes is that when doing natural science and asking the question why is really asking the question how come, not what for. There's a difference. Why that means what for. In other words, giraffes have four necks in order to be able to reach the tops of trees, and that's why they evolved long necks. And that's sort of a purposeful way of speaking about it. And it's a different question to say how come. You know, how come? It's not that to jump from the giraffes to us, right? I think in theology, and I think in spirituality, we tend to ask the why question in the what for terms, both because we're blessed with this ability to be purposeful, and so we tend to look out at the world and project our ability to be purposeful on what we see, and we look for purpose, and we strive to live meaningfully, but really. We're dealing in a world that is how come?
The world is compromised by history. The way I think of this, I think it's a really nice point. I think the where from idea is really important. If we think about anything, whether it's a giraffe's neck or a tiny structure that transfers ions from the outside of a cell into the inside of a cell, okay, we can think about this biologically in two ways. We can think of it as an engineer would think about it. Let's keep things simple and we'll stick to the ions being transferred. So this is a membrane pore, okay? As an engineer, I can solve the problem of transferring potassium ions from point A to point B, okay? And there are various ways I would go about doing that. And in fact, the structure you have in your cell membrane is pretty good at it, actually, and we can resolve it in high detail, measuring things in electron units, and actually see the 3D structure of this and see how it's picking up ions here and parking them over here. Fine. It's pretty good. It's not what an engineer would design. Now, and yet we have this idea that natural selection, and maybe this again is, and I think this is sort of a folk history or maybe a theological trope being overlaid on evolution, the same way we've got the ladder of life being overlaid on it, that because things are designed, they should be perfect. And okay, we've sort of put God in the back of the room in terms of design because we've got this hands-on designer called natural selection. Natural selection is a crap designer quite often. Why? Because that membrane pore is, it's not the perfect engineering solution. It's wildly inefficient by engineering standards, actually. Why? Because it's derived from a transmembrane system that evolved maybe a billion years ago for a completely different function. It's got aspects in common with that. What you had is natural selection's tweaked it, tweaked it, tweaked it, tweaked it, tweaked it, tweaked it. Okay? Until you've got something which is pretty good, but it's constrained, it's hampered by history. Okay? Really nice example, again, bloody Gould. Another Steve Gould example. He wrote Sense of the on the Panda's Thumb. Now, the panda is a bear, and it's a really weird bear, in that it's entirely vegetarian, and eats bamboo, and it has this monochromatic diet. Now, bamboo, as you know, is hard on the outside, and what you want to do is get into the nice, soft stuff on the inside. So you've got to strip off the outside. So what you really want is one of these. The human thumb, your hand, is ideally built, more or less, for stripping bamboo outside, okay? So, oh, what a happy panda that would be if it had its little panda paw with that appended to it, okay? But it's, starting off, this is a hampered by history piece. It's a bear that's got a decorated bear paw, okay? You can't just graft on another firm. So what you've got, yes, you've got natural selection favoring fumminess, if you like. So, yeah, the panda that has something which can sort of serve as a thumb is going to do better than the panda which is fumbling with its bare paws, pure bare paws. And what you have is actually an outgrowth of a wrist bone. It's called the sesamoid bone. And it's this sort of fake thumb. It sort of does the job. Not very good. Okay? It's better than anything else that pandas come up with. So it's the best panda we have today. But that's the idea from design is perfection. Okay? That everything, and again, long distinguished tradition in natural theology, is in actually seeing God's wisdom, if you like, in what he or she has achieved in nature. It's this, God, beautiful design. And yeah, we do see lots of beautiful design, but much of it is deeply imperfect because of the constraints of history of that past. So that's my explication of Ernst Mayr's point on you can't just think in terms of function, you've got to think about where it came from.
This might be a good moment to see where people are with this, and what questions you have that can shape the conversation. All right.
Thank you. Absolutely wonderful, delightful presentation. First, two little comments: one historical, one sociological, about the VHS tape playing the same every time. Back in history, before VHS tapes, we had things called tape recorders.
Yes.
You could erase the tape and then reuse it, and then it would come out different.
Yes, okay.
That was a historical comment. The sociological comment is it's very nice to want to relieve the pain of your evangelical students by coming to speak to a group of future liberal rabbis. Evolution might have developed a better way to do that.
Yes.
those two things aside, I'd like to throw out to you a formulation I've used in my own theological writing for confronting Gould. And that is this. I say it this way, I'm asking how you think it works. Yes, teleology doesn't work, but there is within the evolutionary process an inbuilt tendency toward both diversity and complexity.
Why do you say it's inbuilt?
Because of the possibility of mutation, and therefore the fact that the process can confront needs, can confront changes, and therefore that seems to lead to greater and greater diversity of phenomena and species.
I would challenge that by saying what you've made is effectively, this is going to sound rude, but I apologize, utterly trivial statement. Insofar as the only way in any mechanistic materialist worldview life could have originated is about as simple as it possibly could be. We think probably it was an RNA molecule. In other words, it's something which is more or less capable of replicating itself. Okay, you can't be walking along somewhere about 3.5 billion years ago and suddenly poof, a rabbit appears. Okay, so you've got to start simple. So if you're going to have change, where are you going to go? So you get things are going to become more complicated. It's not necessarily that becoming more complicated is in any grand sense, and this getting back to the idea of trade-off, better than being simple. In fact, many of the simplest forms of life is a virus alive? One of those idiot undergraduate questions we endlessly debate. But think about the effectiveness of Ebola. Ebola's a tiny stretch of DNA. It's incredibly simple, but boy, it works. Okay? So what we have, if you look at the history of life, is yes, things are getting more complex. It's not because of an inbuilt tendency or preference for getting more complex. You're exploring more space of the possibility, obviously, of possibility. You can't have very uber-smart bacteria, okay, simply because there are not enough molecules to accumulate the learned information that makes you smart. That's why we have this incredibly long and inefficient development process, because we're basically growing, seeding, producing experience for this thing. Okay. Now, in other words, that's only possible once a certain level of complexity is adduced. But at the same time, we've still got massive
success of simple things. So there's no vector. And the other thing that is worth noting is it's not a one-way track. There are plenty of instances where things have simplified. Okay? For example, in parasites. So you will have a complex set of insects which are doing really interesting, groovy things. Then one becomes a parasite of another organism. It doesn't need to do all those complex, groovy things. It just needs to have the ability to attach and suck, okay, and reproduce or whatever. And so it loses a lot of its vital functions. So there is not an inbuilt, a one-way vector towards greater complexity. Greater complexity is inevitable if change is going to occur, and change is inevitably going to occur courtesy thermodynamics. The information that we store in a DNA sequence is going to be garbled from time to time, and that's an inevitability, so change is going to occur. If you're starting simple, change is going to occur. Yes, and you run that process, you run your tape for 3.5 billion years, you're going to have more complex things at the end of the day.
Does that suffice to move, does that, and maybe the answer is yes, does that suffice to move from one-celled animals to the complexity of the, let's say, the elephant brain?
I would say yes. Mm-hmm. Other people would say no. Maybe wrong.
I'm interested in your perception of why the student who's leaving in the back of your classroom decided to take your class.
Oh, probably because they're pre-med and required. Sorry, prosaic question. It's actually a problem because I do sometimes teach. So we have in the first year course, we have a genetics and evolution course. I mean, because the two do interdigitate a lot, and it is required for the students who are pre-med. It's that situation. They're not there because they want to learn about evolution. Though I do get those as well, and actually that's rather nice. The kids who feel they've missed something in their education, but they're probably not weeping, but they're just troubled, and they'll come in and have long conversations with me. But no, I'm sorry about the rather prosaic answer. Yeah?
Could you talk a little bit about punctuated equilibrium and how it's possible for their periods of time for a greater amount of change to happen in species?
Yep. So punctuated equilibrium is... This is Gould Fest, isn't it?
Yes.
So it's an idea which was actually introduced in 1973 by Stephen Jay Gould and a guy called Narzel, who does the Naturalist Museum in New York City, which posited that the, quote, traditional model of evolutionary change, as championed by Darwin on, which they characterized as something called phyletic gradualism, was wrong. And phyletic gradualism, and this is where I need a chalkboard, is if we've got some axis of, well, let's say size of your organism, okay, along here, and we've got a time axis here, you have, you know, the thing's getting bigger slowly over time, okay? That's phyletic gradualism, okay? Gould said, look at the fossil record. Let's actually be, you know, serious students of the fossil record, and you will see that things stay the same. You don't see this. Rather, you see same. So again, something is staying the same size, same. And then suddenly, it disappears and is replaced. Suddenly, this is a blink of an eye in the geological record. This might have been 500,000 years, remember? And then suddenly, stay the same at the larger size. Okay? Now, first observation is, Gould was the master of argument by straw man. That vision of phyletic gradualism of constant change is pure straw manery. I can cite you chapter as bloody Darwin, saying, under no circumstances do we make simple assumptions about constant rates of change. Rates of change are going to vary. Remember what I just told you. The rate of change of running speed of zebras is entirely dependent on whether they're lions or not. So, and that population is not evolving in that regard. This one is. Okay. So one, that characterization is unreasonable. Two, what Gould's done actually is useful. So he has pointed out an empirical pattern, which maybe previously we'd be inclined to gloss over and say, yes, we've got that, but we'll just sort of draw that. Okay, so fine, but is this discordant with standard theory? Answer is absolutely no.
In fact, arguably, that's what you expect to see. Why? Because once something has evolved and it works, almost all of what natural selection is doing is keeping it the same, right? You don't want to be too far. Well, the famous example of this kind of natural selection is human baby size. Natural selection has long operated, it's no longer really operating, but to keep humans babies at about 7 pounds. You don't want to be too small, because baby will... Thank you for the 7 pounds. you don't want to be too small, because baby will probably die, is not adequately nourished or whatever. You don't want to be too big, because you won't probably, at pre-caesarean, won't be able to get out of mum, so you'll die and kill mum at the same time, okay? So what does that mean? You're lopping off the ends of the distributions, the two smalls and the two big. You're keeping everything the same. And almost all natural selection is doing that. Think about it. You, and it was taking you a while, that you're going to travel in time way back here. You were once the product of the fusion of two gametes, okay? This is bad, mum and dad, right? You're dealing with an egg and a sperm, and there it is. It's two strings of information, effectively, okay? The paternal and maternal information. And then, I just think it's stunning. I mean, you want wonder. You have a transformation from that single cell to, I can't remember what the current estimate is. It's like you consist of 50 trillion coordinate. Somebody looks around at you. Okay. Not you. He's got more cells than everyone else. 50 trillion cells, and it's exquisitely coordinated. You've got different organ systems, and they're all coordinated. It's amazing, that transformation. Okay, and most of it, of course, occurs in the first 9 months of life, post-conception. What has happened is you've got bits of information from those two genomes which are going about this amazingly choreographed process to develop a human being. And that involves, obviously, lots of different bits interacting with each other, different proteins interacting with each other, different proteins interacting with bits of DNA and RNA and so on. So, now, I'm going to go in there and make a random change. Okay? Just change something. This is a set of exquisitely interacting parts. I make a random change, what's going to happen? I'm going to screw it up. Okay, I mean, think about a simple example. Your dad's 1982 Ford Taurus. Now, talk about a simple engine. But if you open the hood of your dad's car, maybe when he's not around, and make a random change, shove in an iron bar, pull something out, and that's an incredibly simple machine. It's a relatively few interacting parts. You are the product of vast numbers of interacting parts. So the point is, almost all mutation is deleterious. And that's the job of natural selection, is to eliminate it. So we expect natural selection to keep things the same. If something's working, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, okay? Now, why then? So the fact you see sameness in the fossil record is actually deeply unremarkable. Why do things change? Well, let's say the lions suddenly arrive on that island. Some contingent environmental effect has occurred. The lions have built a bridge or whatever. Or we built a bridge and the lions say, thank you very much. So suddenly you've got very strong selection on those fat, lazy zebras where none was before. So what's going to happen is you'll get, because of a contingent environmental change, you've got relatively rapid, after a long period of stasis, you've got relatively rapid change. So again, with the resolution of the fossil record, that would happen over 100 generations. That's a blink of an eye by the standard of the fossil record. And again, if what we're measuring is same speed, same speed, same speed, suddenly you see faster running. Well, see what I mean? There is, and that's the point. This was a storm in a teacup. It was a piece of Gouldian career self-promotion, frankly, punctuated equilibrium. It doesn't change our understanding of the evolutionary process one jot. It's an interesting idea, it's a stimulating idea, but it's just part of the main structure of evolution.
Dan, how much time do we have?
30 minutes.
Okay, great. Because I want to get to more questions in a second, but one thing I want to make sure we touch on, and it relates to something that Andrew just said, is exceptionalism when it comes to human beings. And let's take an example, the tendency we have to select for the weakest which is to say, the very unusual, I think, in biological terms, let's say spiritual care for those least likely to survive, that human beings tend to exercise. Where do you see that fitting in biologically?
So obviously there's a huge literature on the evolution of moral systems. Darwin wrote about it, and he had what I think was a bogus argument, what we call a group selection argument, and it was this, that you've got two tribes, one of which, every individual is entirely selfish, so they're just looking out for themselves, okay? It's every man, woman, child for themselves, okay? The other one has a genetic difference which causes them to look out for each other. Okay, so in battle, when somebody's coming up behind you, I'm going to throw myself in front of your assailant and so on. Whereas in group A, that wouldn't happen. Okay, and his argument is, and it's correct, that the second group, B, because they're better at collaborating and cooperating, are going to outcompete in terms of resources or whatever it is, the selfish group. Okay, so that was his model for the evolution of morality, if you like. I mean, just writ large, of altruism, if you like. It doesn't work. And let me explain why. Imagine that's just happened, and we now have a population of the altruistic, the group B nice guys. Okay. Now imagine a genetic change in one of those individuals that makes, and I'm going to use a technical biological term, and I apologize if it grates on your ears, he's an asshole. Okay? He's a selfish bastard. Okay. Now, think about it. He's going to benefit from all the niceness of the people around him. He's in clover, man. But he's giving nothing back. So he's at a huge advantage. So that trait is going to be passed on. So the point is, that kind of group-inspired altruism, sometimes this is a sort of for the good of the species argument, doesn't work. Okay. The same applies, so the for the good of the species is, the canonical example, Google example, is lemmings. Now, the notion, so these are Scandinavian rodents, and they famously commit suicide for the good of the species. And the premise is that the population size has expanded such that they're going to eat out all their resources. Okay. Now, that's catastrophic for the species, because if they eat out all their resources, then they will die. End of story. End of species, right? Okay. So what you want to do is trim the population so there's enough to go around. And the premise was that that's what they actually do. Once they reach a certain population density, you've got a bunch of them that leap into the ocean and die. And this is nobility, right? Self-sacrifice for the good of the species. Now, well, it turns out that's almost certainly just that the natural history is completely unsound. That yes, you get mass migrations when times are hard, when you run out of food here. So you do see them trying to swim across wide rivers, but that's only because they're hungry. They're not committing suicide. Okay? But the foolishness of this conjecture is beautifully pointed out by Gary Larson, the cartoonist. He has this lovely picture of these little chubby cartoon lemmings charging heroically, self-sacrificially into the ocean. Except for one, who's in the group, but he's got a buoyancy. It's exactly the same argument as I've just given you about the asshole arising in the altruistic group. Okay, so these group, what we call group selection or for the good of the species type arguments do not work. So where does this come from? Part of it, at least, is what we call kin selection, okay? We are preternaturally nice to our relatives. Mm. There's good biological arguments, as you know. These are sort of Richard Dawkins-y type arguments. They didn't originate with Dawkins, but he popularized them with the selfish gene. The bottom line is there are multiple ways in which I can pass my genes. And the sort of algorithm of natural selection is about passing genes onto the next selection. You really sort of pare everything else away. I can obviously have my own kids, but I can also help my relatives have lots of kids. Okay? Now, it's more efficient. There's more of me and my kids.
let's say Jonah is my brother, so there's 50% of me in each of my kids. There's only, and you can do the sums, there's 25% of me in each of Jonah's kids, because there's 50% of me and Jonah, okay? So to do the sums, I've got to, if I'm not going to have kids, I've got to help Jonah raise at least 4 kids, okay, to replace every 2 of mine. You see what I'm saying? Okay, kin selection. And that applies across the board. And that explains, for example, social insects. Why does a worker honeybee commit suicide? Does commit suicide defending the hive? When that bee stings you, it disembowels itself, it's dead. Okay. And the answer, and also, why does the worker honeybee not reproduce? I mean, going back to our little bacterial friend, duh, that's exactly what you're not supposed to do. Well, it turns out, again, if you do the genetic sums, that by not reproducing but helping mum, the queen, reproduce, the worker is doing herself more of a favor in terms of passing herself on to the next generation than she could be by herself. So yes, there's some evolutionary tendency for what you might call in-group, within-family morality, one. Two, one thing which is incontrovertible is this thing is absolutely extraordinary. And this is a case, I think, of human exceptionalism. And yeah, we can feel good about elephants being smart and dolphins. And yeah, there are plenty of smart animals out there, but nobody's close. Not even a really smart chimpanzee comes close in terms of just mental functioning and the ability to learn. What does that mean? It means that we are, yes, partly a product of our genes, and yes, we do pay special attention to our offspring and so on, and that probably is some sort of inbuilt module, moral model, sort of kin-oriented moral module, but we also are exceptionally efficient at picking up and internalizing cues from our environment. We learn stuff. And that's what's special and remarkable about us. So in a sense, we can transcend the selfishness, which might actually be what we're in some sort of preternatural, it's a very primitive way programmed to be, with culture. So it's culture that makes us the wonderful things that we are. Sorry, that was a long, well, they're all long answers.
So in theology, we have origin stories.
Yeah.
Like Judeo-Christian, the story of Genesis. I'm curious what the origin of life stories are in the scientific field, biologists, evolutionists. What do you look for when you try to explain the origins of life? And I suppose a related or an overlapping question with theology might be, is there some inevitability to the origin of life?
Really interesting question. So, the origin of life, as we currently understand it, and it's very difficult. We certainly can't know. Okay, this is 3.5 billion years ago, and we don't have a fossil record for molecules. Okay, the current thinking, and as I say, this will probably actually will evolve. There's always been a chicken and egg problem. You need for a living system. Obviously, this is somewhat going to depend on what you define as life. But a living system has to somehow store and encode information about itself. So probably it's going to be a biopolymer of some kind. It's going to be a string of molecules glued together. But it's also got to have the ability to self-replicate. Okay. So once you've got a set of information that has encoded in itself, if you like, the ability to replicate itself, we're going to call that life. Now, you might find that unsatisfactory. You're not going to have an interesting conversation with it. But the chicken and egg problem was that traditionally, if you look at living systems today, you need a storage molecule, that's DNA, so you've got a sequence of information. But you also need what you might call an active actuating molecule. DNA is just a string. It would sit there, high, a string. It's not replicated. Okay? And we replicate DNA with a set of proteins, okay? Which, yes, ultimately are derived from the DNA, but you've got a real chicken and egg problem there. So you need the proteins to replicate the DNA, and you need the DNA to generate the proteins, okay? The solution seems to be this intermediate molecule called RNA, which is very similar to DNA, and RNA is still a big part of living systems, as I'm sure you're aware. We just had a lecture on epigenetics, for crying out loud. RNA is interesting. It does the same thing as DNA. It stores information. It also, curiously enough, has catalytic properties like an enzyme. So it can act both as a storage molecule and as a protein. So the chicken, this is very zen, but the chicken is the egg. Now, there are all sorts of technical problems in terms of exactly, you know, how that arose given early life conditions and so on. They've explained some experiments you're probably aware of where you can simulate early atmospheres. And it turns out, and this is interesting, it's not that difficult, you know, with a bit of heating up and a few simple molecules, some ammonia and some carbon dioxide, whatever. Not carbon dioxide, methane probably. And a spark or whatever to simulate electricity. To produce a bunch of basic building blocks, molecules. The interesting thing, and this is controversial, the interesting thing, it does seem that life arose on our planet pretty much as soon as it could do. Okay? So 4.4 billion years ago, more or less, is the formation of the planet. You then had a period, and we know this geologically, of asteroid bombardment. I mean, basically, the place was a wasteland, so nothing could happen. So once that stopped, bang, it seems we've got evidence, and there's various geochemical ways in which you can, biogeochemical ways, you can infer from deposits in rocks, really early rocks. And probably, it almost depends on what you define life, but what we would choose to call life is happening. Probably what happened is there were probably lots of proto-life forms on Earth, and the one we have, the one we are, is the one that happened to outcompete the other one. So, given that, I'm saying that the origin of life is actually not a super low probability. Well, it is. A particular event is a super low probability occasion, but this is happening in little puddles anywhere there's a little puddle, okay? And there's a lot of little puddles on the surface of the planet, okay? Mm-hmm. So even though each particular event is low probability, you've got so many replicants, if you like, replicants of that experiment that's going to happen. So which is why, in a sense, the astrobiology shtick, which is off looking for so-called exoplanets that would, in principle, be viable for life. Yes, okay, it's 8 zillion light years away or whatever. But once you've identified them and use these spectroscopic methods and so on to try and figure out what the atmosphere is like and so forth, my guess is there's plenty of life out there. So I don't think life actually is that unlikely. But what, in a sense, is then interesting, and we go back to Steve Gould and his VHS tape, or his self-made, self-recorded tape, depending on your perspective, is if you've got life, and you're on a planet, you know, which has, you know, conditions not too far removed from it, what's the outcome? We don't know. And it is a real problem, because it's a long way away. So, you know, just the constraints of physics make communication over those ridiculous grand swaths of space impractical. But I think it's really cool and interesting. Yeah?
I have a question for you about whether humans are special.
Yeah.
Because I think you've so far argued that we're not so special, we're just special in this particular way.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering what you think of the idea that, terrifyingly, we have the ability. I don't believe that elephants could kill all of us if they wanted to. I'm confident we could kill all of them.
Yep.
And bacteria is a little trickier, although we've made tremendous strides in wiping out bacteria. And I wonder what you think about that, about saying that we actually may have reached the pinnacle, which is that we, I think, uniquely have the ability to destroy the world.
That's a rather arbitrary category of success.
Fair enough, although I think in some way I think that if the name of the game is, you know, outcompete, outwin, outlast survivor, I think we have reached that they can't take us down, we can take them down.
If we take them down, we take us down.
Yeah, no, that's the terrifying part,
yeah,
for sure. But
especially right now,
But at some level, do you think that's really just an arbitrary definition of success, or at some level, is that really something?
No, I think it's an arbitrary definition. I mean, it's true. I'm absolutely not disputing it.
Right.
It's just something we stumbled into, and yeah, we have this power, which means hopefully we're going to be responsible and sensible about it. And
I wouldn't guess that, but yeah.
Yeah.
Laura.
So actually, building on that, I've been thinking about how there are some people who connect to or see the divine as manifest in the interconnectedness between all of these systems, within our bodies, within the world, within ecosystems. And I guess I'm wondering, are there any examples within evolutionary biology of beings that have sort of existed or been able to exist relatively independent of other systems in that way that we sometimes, in a very anthropocentric way, think of humans? I'm not saying that that's the human reality.
It depends what you mean by independent of other systems. I mean, so there are bacteria. I mean, you need a source of energy if you're going to be alive, okay? So if the source of energy is part of the system, then no, you can't be independent of that. But there are plenty of instances. So, in the wonderful world of microbiology today, we have these things called extremophiles. So, for example, these are bacteria that live deep in rocks. They have metabolism which is completely alien to anything we're familiar with. Obviously, not my. Most bacteria are pretty similar to you and me in that you use oxygen and so on and so forth. Okay? These things have evolved metabolisms to use the energy within the bonds, within the chemical bonds of the mineral of that rock. Now, I don't know if that satisfies your criterion of independence.
I guess my underlying question is. I often encounter people who really do think of humans as exceptional and separate and the pinnacle of everything.
Yeah.
And
By the way, I'm absolutely happy, again, with the separate, special, exceptional. We are. No, we are smarter than anything else out there, and we value smartness. It's like a little humility vis-a-vis the bacteria that can help reproduce. We're not the pinnacle. We're good at doing one thing. We're lousy at doing other things. It's this idea of trade-off. Yeah.
So one of the things I'm asking is how we go about value another life when we see ourselves as so exceptional.
Oh, I think it's a really interesting, important question. Am I a vegetarian? I think we should simply be pragmatic about it, frankly, and selfish about it. I mean, I think selfishness is something we shouldn't be ashamed of. It's in our interest to value other life. Okay? Plain and simple. And that means every species. Every species has the potential to unlock drugs that might cure infant diseases that you haven't even encountered yet. There are plenty of, I won't say, well, not extensive studies, but there's plenty of information that suggests that a human being is in a much better mental and probably physical state if somewhat exposed. I'm not saying you have to spend all the time tromping around in the mountains or the forest, but actually having a real engagement with the natural world. So I think it's fairly straightforward. I don't think we have to make a sort of special plea that we have some moral response. No, I think if we want to look after ourselves, and I think we should want to look after ourselves, speaking as a parent, right? I have children who maybe will make a mistake of reproducing themselves. It's in my interest, and again, this is a sort of kin selection, because I can relate to my children and their futures. It's in everyone's interest to make sure the environment is in good shape. I know that's a really boring and sort of prosaic answer, but I guess that's what I'm doing now.
I just want to make sure Andy gets a chance to.
Oh,
really fascinating. Thank you. I'm wondering to tweak Art's theology a little bit and hear your response. What if we think about not natural selection in any different way than you suggested, kind of contextualized randomness, but you think of supernatural selection in the sense that a theology might suggest that the way things have evolved given all those historical constraints and contingencies, at a certain point, God becomes interested in a particular species.
Yeah.
There's a selection of a relationship.
Yeah.
Meaning there's a lot of things happening, but this one is interesting.
Yeah. Fortunately, you're not saying God set the system going and just sitting waiting because he knows if he waits long enough, humans are going to appear. What you're saying is he's coming back and checking from time to time, something I can have a relationship
with. Now, retrospectively, what theology tends to do is say, well, we're interested in only those things that God is interested in. So there's a kind of teleology in the sense that that's what becomes the focus of our attention. But it seems to me that theologically we can deal with your contingent constrained randomness and sort of suggest that there's a selection that's going on with a different set of criteria.
I'm utterly happy with that. I mean, and this is a classical application.
That God is much too arbitrary.
But it's not arbitrary.
It's a classical application of the non-overlapping magisteria. So I've got my magisteria where I've got this contingent, non-deterministic process, which serendipitously has produced two-legged grade apes with big brains. And you have I call a theological magisterium, where you have good cause to understand why God would be the divine would be interested in having a relationship.
Right, but one of the differences is once God makes that selection, that actually does change the value of the system.
Yeah.
Meaning it has an impact if, from a theological perspective, what God says, I'm interested in this, and I'm less interested in this, or I don't have the same quality relationship.
We are the chosen species.
Yes, exactly.
I mean, the teleology actually makes a very stronger claim about chosen.
And I'm completely happy with that, again, because as long as the divine special interest in this particular species isn't going to stop offending natural laws, that's and I guess one of my problems, again, this is the weeping kid in my class, it's coming to terms with scientific, I'm going to call them truths, is such an uncomfortable process for so many people. And thinking like that, I think, is a nice sort of way in which that kid, it's all right, you've still got your relationship with Will.
So one more, and then I want to take a moment just to wrap up.
My question is sort of a follow-up to Eric's and Laura's, and even Jonah's point earlier about favoring the weaker in some aspects. So if as a species we are capable of actually destroying the Earth, but we need all of the systems working as this complex thing, Earth, all together, in order to survive, why is there this phenomenon of people who are refusing to honor the connectivity of all the systems in what we're seeing of these rising numbers of people who don't believe in climate change and are basically going to destroy the Earth, which is going to destroy the species? And if we're trying to perpetuate the species,
it's a really interesting question. I'm going to give you a sort of evolutionary psychology answer, which would probably be slightly unsatisfying, but it's the best I can do, which is we evolved to think short-term, to solve the problem short-term. We evolved on the plains of Africa. The immediate problem was the lion hiding behind that bookcase. The immediate problem is the guys in the village over the hill who want to kill me, okay? And my neighbors. We've evolved to think short term, okay? And that's our perspective, okay? The people you're talking about, bless their tiny orange hands, are doing just that, okay? So by denying climate change, it means I can allow American factories to maximally pollute, okay, and so they can save money on climate control and so on, and that's going to So short-term revenue is enhanced. That's all we're dealing with, is blinkered short-term thinking. But I seriously, and this is a problem. I don't know about you. I mean, planning is something, you know, in a sense, we're not, as a species, not really good at on a long, we're good at quick fixes. And I really think that is because that's what we evolved to do, because that's all we had to do. You didn't have to make long-term, I mean, think about it. In the old days, food was something you had to get, and you couldn't store it, really. We didn't have refrigerators or freezers, right? So it wasn't a matter of, okay, I can get lots of food now, I can lay it ahead, and I can eat it for the next, you know, 12 years. No, it was something that happened on a week-in, week-out cycle. So I do think that there's something biological about our inability to really grapple with long-term problems.
So in conclusion, for my part, wrap up as well. The thing is that I believe everything that Andrew says, and at the same time, I daven. I mean, I pray. I, you know, dedicated a life and an existence and a shared life to exploring and protracting this tradition with you and with people like you. And I constantly ask myself about the sense of that. So I'm going to read you something briefly, and my fear is that Andrew may, like Danny's theological approach, more than he'll like this, but I'm asking him publicly to poke holes in this for just a second if he wants to. And why I'm afraid of Danny's a bit is because I love a God who's infinitely interested, you know, which means something about the infinitude of the divine to me implies an equal distribution of interest. But that would mean a God who's interested in Ebola. So, you know, that's interesting too and challenging. I'm not saying you're necessarily wrong. We can't know. So I wrote a while back trying to think this out for myself, and now let me acknowledge that this is deeply, deeply influenced by art and substantively taught by him too, although I take responsibility for whatever is different here. So in the talking about beginnings, in the beginning of our cosmos, there was an impulse to create that entailed in itself the possibility of everything we ever know to have happened in this universe and everything that ever will happen. In a moment of trust or faith or hope or sheer insistence upon self-expression, such as human terms cannot possibly encompass, the impulse's source, which from our vantage point boggles the mind as the unfathomable no-thing before time, took a step into physical actuality. It was an explosive step, a sudden tumult of existence, perfusing in nanoseconds and over eons, roiling, changing subatomic particles, flying apart from them, consolidating themselves under governing variables, co-evolving through a tug-of-war into something like stability, the resulting atoms coming together here and there through vast expanses of being as best we can glimpse and fathom the beginning. Everything was possible in that one first step, but only possible. In some instances, highly likely, in some extraordinarily improbable. It would all depend on how things went, each frame of the film strip depending on the occurrences of each previous one. We know enough today not to speak of clockwork inevitabilities, but of clouds of possibility. It's difficult to determine where we ourselves fall in the range of likelihood. What reckoning we can manage suggests that our species, capable of such contemplation, must be an extraordinarily rare being, which is saying a lot considering the scale of the place and of time. Throughout enormous expanses of time and space, nothing much seems to happen at all. The universe is a nearly empty and almost uneventful expanse, a thin, loose web of substance and occurrence over giant tracts of darkness, of nothing we can see. Here and there, bits of hydrogen get together and get interesting. This has happened before in several cycles, starting much earlier than the birth of our sun. The heavier elements we know today can only have been generated in supernova explosions, the demise of the previous generation of stars from a more undifferentiated time. Our moment, too, will pass. Meanwhile, where elements come together, possibilities multiply. Things happen. the ancient generative impulse tries on many forms. How does it go for them? That depends on so many things. Right here, right now, on this tiny planet, on the physical scale of our human hands, and at this juncture of the story of earthly life, the answer turns out to depend greatly upon what we humans choose to do with our eyes open. In that way, one of these cosmic moments is not like the others. That is as mind-boggling and awe-inspiring a truth as any tale told in ancient terms of legend. Has such a thing ever happened before? Will it ever happen again? As far as we know, there's just this one chance for us to show what happens when it does. It could be a sad and ugly story where our part in the beauty of the survival of terrestrial life is concerned, or it could be something else. Let us make a human being.
That is beautiful, by the way. And I find nothing even remotely objectionable with it. No, I think that was a lovely expression.
Yeah. So I wanted just to wrap up by saying I think this is a worthwhile exploration, a worthwhile commitment to live honestly in a scientifically informed world, because that's part of the uniqueness of this moment and the uniqueness of our capability as human beings. Whatever is going on, and whatever science will tell us and continue to tell us is going on, we have this amazing capability to take part in it consciously. That to me, you know, is pretty much, I mean, I use the word miraculous of that because I don't have another term for it. And it may be, you know, that it's most sensible to see it as happenstantial and as random. And at the same time, it's sort of the birdsong of our species that I experience very deeply is this turn toward, well, if our eyes are open and if we can be aware, then there's also this capacity for meaning making that goes along with
absolutely with
forward looking. So
no.
If you want to wrap up with that.
Well, so yeah, I mean, I'm not going to ignore what you say, except basically say I completely agree with everything you said, John. But because you brought something to read at the end, I brought something to read.
Yeah.
So much for a conversation. I want to finish with Darwin, it seems appropriate. Darwin had a colleague actually here at Harvard, A.C. Gray, who was arguably the botanist, who was Darwin's sort of main bridgehead into American academia, who's Darwin's champion. But he was a very religious man, a Christian Protestant, and he could never come to terms with the pure sort of nihilistic component, the unguided, the non-teleological component. And he devised his own theory. I mean, it was, in retrospect, a failure, but it was an interesting attempt. He, at that stage, of course, variation, what we call genetic variation, which we now is DNA mutations, was a black box. So he conjectured, he bought natural selection, he conjectured that the divine intervened at the level of variation, that the divine made the appropriate variation and then natural selection got to work selecting it. Now, we know that's not true. Darwin had plenty of good arguments against it, and there's this wonderful exchange of letters, very respectful exchange of letters. But essentially, Gray is a natural theologian. He's seeing God's work in creation, and Darwin isn't. What I want you to get out of this, though, is the fact it irritates me, by the way. Darwin's my icon, okay? But he gets sucked into this vortex of militant atheism and or so-called humanism or whatever. I don't think he was an atheist, okay? He certainly wasn't a doctrinaire religionist. He'd certainly long since forsworn, you know, standard Church of England practices and so on. And I think this is a nice statement. He wrote to Gray in the midst of this transatlantic dispute they were having, the following. With respect to the theological view of the question, this is always painful to me. I'm bewildered. I had no intention to write atheistically, but I own I cannot see as plainly as others do, and maybe as I should and wish to, evidence of design and beneficence on all sides of us. There seems to be too much misery in the world. I cannot persuade myself that a beneficent and omnipotent God would have designedly created the Gnuman wasp with the express intention of their feeding within the living bodies of caterpillars. That's how the grubs are
raised, or that a cat should sadistically play with a mouse it is about to eat. Not believing this, I see no necessity in the belief that the eye was expressly designed. On the other hand, I cannot anyhow be contented with the to view this wonderful university, wonderful universe, and this is the Jonah part, and especially the nature of man, and to conclude that everything is the result of brute force. I'm inclined to look at everything as resulting, yes, from design laws, with the details, whether good or bad, left to the working out of what we may call chance. Not that this notion at all satisfies me. I feel most deeply, and this is really what I wanted to say, because I think it's a beautiful, essentially, it's an abdication, and it is an embrace of the twin magisteria. I feel most deeply that the whole subject is too profound for the human intellect. A dog, Darwin writes, might as well speculate on the mind of Newton. I think that's a lovely statement. No, thank you very much.